Hello, I'm Steve Goucher. Eastern religions, such as Buddhism and Hinduism, are growing in the United States thanks in part to immigration, religious conversions, and social media. But what is the appeal to the Western world? And will globalization of Eastern religions threaten the cultures and traditions of those very ancient faiths? Joining me to discuss the globalization of Eastern religions is Nathan Katz, professor in the Department of Religious Studies at Florida International University, Dr. Jalil Thurber, emergency physician and a member of the Miami Beach Baha'i community. Rita Das Mittal is a volunteer chair and executive committee secretary of the South Florida Hindu Temple in Southwest Ranches, and Ellen Soto of Soka Gakkai International USA, a Buddhist association for peace, culture, and education, and a practicing Buddhist. Welcome to the program.
Thank you.
I was going to start this by saying the usual suspects are not here. We have no Christians, we have no Christians, Jews, or Muslims represented as we explore the growing popularity of what are basically new religions to the United States that come out of the Far East or the Middle East, and see why that's happening. Doctor, tell me what there is about Eastern religions or the East that seems to give birth to such ancient religions.
It's the Western imagination. because the East, so-called, was the other side of the world, so whatever we're not, they are. Whatever we are, they're not. That's the way European perceptions have structured.
But there are no foundational Western religions, are there?
Unless one considers indigenous religions
in this
part of the world. Yeah. No, all of the world's religions grow up east of somewhere. Now, how far east do you want to go?
But there is a sort of a theological difference between the way in which the West has developed Christianity, for instance, and the East has developed their understanding of worldview, is there not?
There are many, many ways of understanding the world if you're Christian, and many, many ways if you're Hindu. So some of the Christian ways are more similar to some of the Hindu ways than they are to other Christian ways.
So it's inappropriate to suggest that there's a sort of a definition for an Eastern religion.
I would say that.
Coming out of Hinduism and from India, I grew up in Bombay, and I'm a practicing Hindu since I remember. But I think the way the Easterners think is more, how do you get yourself to do better? I think we don't have any structured God as such, or a prophet. So I think we look inside and around us, and we want to be one with nature, and we don't want to go against it. So we learn from what is around us, and we try to find God outside and inside of us.
Are you suggesting that it's more ethically based than it is based in some mystery?
I think so. I think it was probably a very practical way of dealing with it centuries ago.
That's fascinating, because I find Hinduism very mysterious. tell me about, you're a Baha'i.
I'm a member of the
Baha'i. I suspect Baha'i is a relatively new word for lots of Americans.
You're absolutely right. In terms of all the world religions that you've mentioned and we've been discussing, the Baha'i faith is actually the youngest. It's been around for a little bit over 160 years. It originally...
What's that,
1844 is when the Baha'i faith started.
Where?
In Iran.
Started in Iran?
Yes, in the Middle East. And even though it's the Middle East, it's technically not considered an Eastern religion. And when you Google Eastern religion, it says that these are religions that originate in India or Asia, like Japan.
Or China.
And the more classical definition or distinction is that they're not Abrahamic or Semitic religions. They're not religions that originated in that part of the world. We're talking about the Middle East.
And Baha'i is, in fact, an offshoot of one of the Abrahamic faiths, is it not?
It is. Its origins are in the sense that we believe in Abraham, and it does have its genealogy from there. It is an Abrahamic or Semitic religion. It has its roots in Christianity, Judaism, and Islam. And in that sense, you're correct.
Am I also correct to say that Baha'i would say that they are the fulfillment of those three faiths?
The Baha'i's belief is that there is always a need for an educator, And that one of the things that you do find in common even between Eastern religions and the Semitic or Abrahamic religions is that they're always talking about a fulfillment or a promised one to come, a Messiah of sorts. Hinduism, we talked about, in Hinduism there's the 10th reincarnation of Vishnu or the 10th avatar. In Buddhism there's the Maitreya. In Christianity we're talking about the return of Jesus Christ. Right. In Judaism, the Messiah. In Islam, they're also awaiting the Mahdi, which coincides with the return of Christ. And the Baha'is do believe that, in essence, the religions, every time a new chapter in the unfoldment of religion occurs, it is a fulfillment of the previous prophecy. And the Baha'i faith being the latest, according to the Baha'is, it is a fulfillment, in essence, of all the other previous prophecies.
Of course, that's what Muhammad said, didn't he? That he was the fulfillment of Judaism.
And that's what Christ
and Christianity,
said as well.
And Christianity. So everybody that
so
comes...
So it does fit in that family very neatly,
yeah.
Doesn't it?
But now, does Hinduism have a messianic expectation?
Not at all. Actually, Hinduism really, I think a lot of people believe that we have a lot of gods. But actually, the basic way we look at Hinduism is really there's one God, and we have no name. It's really the sound like Om, which actually embodies everything. And we believe in, but then, like I was saying, I mean, it's more like a practical thing. Because in order to explain all the mysteries of the world, they try to make these gods like the ancient Greeks or the Romans. But we don't have an angry god. I mean, we do have Shiv as the angry god, but he gets mad only when things are not going the right way. And he wakes up only once in a while. But he's a very forgiving god. I mean, we all like him because you pray to him, and he's also known as Bholanath. Means he forgets.
All of the various gods of Hinduism are manifestations of the of or of the central god.
Yes.
Is that correct?
If you are really spiritual, there is actually no differentiation. It's just Om. There's one God, but for the lay people, yes, we have hundreds of gods.
It helps to have some anthropological. I guess not. That's not mm-hmm. the right word for Hinduism, but Buddhism. Mm-hmm. No God.
Right.
Say more about that.
Well, I think, going back to what Rita mentioned, this kind of difference between the Abrahamic traditions and Eastern traditions is that, it focuses more on this relationship with God, the Abrahamic traditions.
Right.
And Buddhism is more about, introspection and self-mastery and really taking this journey within. And then also cultivating, the virtues of being what it means to be a human being. And then through that kind of exploration, you begin to discover that the very qualities that you possess are also the qualities, that everyone else possesses. So you start to see this interconnectedness between people.
So how are Hinduism and Buddhism separated?
Okay, the way it goes is Hinduism, I mean, there is no beginning point, but they can trace it to something like 7th century BC to 5th century BC is when we had the Upanishads. They are like the ancient books. But during that time, again, it was very spiritual. It's your relationship with God. And that time we had whatever you do, that's your karma. You have certain, and there's a dharma, the way the Hindus believe is like, we are put on this earth to do fulfill certain things, different stages of life. Right. So we don't have to really give up and become a monk or go away from social life. But as a child, your duty is to really learn. So there are all these things. That is your dharma. That's your duty. And your karma is, again, what you do with that duty. Are you a good student? Are you a good child? Are you respecting your parents?
And is there a judgment on that?
Nope. It's really all your judgment, because what you do,
so
you
get.
It
doesn't matter whether you live up to your karma.
Well, it's based on
a it's reincarnation.
Cause and effect, right?
It's a cause and effect. I mean, you do good karma, you get probably good deeds.
Judgment, but no judge,
yes.
I think we could
no
say.
No judge.
Oh,
right.
That's interesting.
We used to
nice
have a judge, actually, between the 7th and the 5th century, they did think of three gods, Yama, Som, and Indra.
Right.
They were the ones who would judge you and then put you away according to your deeds.
Okay.
And they didn't know what happened then because the soul didn't die. And it was supposed to be in a little prison somewhere.
Doctor, is there a first cause in the religious world out from which all of these things come?
Nothing that I can tell you, but I can say that religions tend to emphasize different things in different places and different times. So Ellen was speaking very eloquently about the inner cultivation that is so much part of Buddhist tradition, which it is. And Christians, Jews, Muslims, Sufis, Kabbalists, yes, all have their own traditions of inner contemplation and inner development. But as we say, at different times and places, certain things get emphasized. Mm-hmm. And when Buddhism and Hinduism, in fact, were first presented on this continent in the late 19th century, what was presented was exactly what most Christians in this country didn't think they had in their own tradition. Mm-hmm. So it's meditation, inner cultivation, and that was the export variety of Buddhism and Hinduism that came in this country.
And so that's what made it popular in this country.
That's what people grasp, and that's what they assumed they didn't have.
Was missing from their own faith, Christianity, because I know I have a friend who's an Episcopal priest who's a practicing Buddhist, and I said, is that a contradiction in terms? And he said, no, Buddhism has no God. Buddhism is a way of life, and I follow that way of life in order to be obedient to my Abrahamic God. So it's a little confusing, but
understand this principle of cause and effect, the more deeply you understand the principle, then the more deeply, you know, you want to abide by living a good and just life. So it's like, as you were saying, there isn't this, judge, but you yourself kind of gauge, you know, your own life. So by the effects that you see, those things determine or kind of reflect the sort of causes you've made. So if you want to change the outcome, you have to change the kind of causes that you make. So it becomes more self-motivated.
And you are more akin to me, for instance, of a practitioner of basically a Western religion, but a Middle Eastern. You have the God of Abraham.